This is Toshio, yeah, and so obviously he's our main speaker today. I think he needs very little introduction, but a couple of things that I found interesting. He actually majored in oil painting at the Tokyo National University of Fine Arts and Music, mainly Japanese as Geidai, and then went to Ghent, where he studied photography at the Royal Academy. And it seems that the experience of being outside Japan, perhaps, made him see Japan with new eyes. So anyway, well, I won't speculate much about what's made his work what it is, because that's what he's going to tell you. And together with him, we have Dr. Philip Prodger, who is the head of photographs at the National Portrait Gallery. And Dr. Prodger actually also was the curator of one of Toshio's exhibitions in the States at the Peabody Essex Museum. So that's kind of the connection there. And I also ought to mention Martin van Pielsen. So Martin runs a gallery in Antwerp called Ivashop, which represents Toshio. And in fact, the works you can see will come over from there. And if you were to want to buy any of them, Martin's the person you need to be talking to. So I think without further ado, I'm going to let you get on. Perhaps I should just mention how this is going to work. There's going to be a presentation, first of all, from Toshio with images. And then it's going to be a bit of a discussion with Philip. And then we will throw it open to Q&A. So please, I think, about any cues you might like to ask. And then we'll go downstairs and look at the work again and have another drink. And you're very welcome at that point to go up and talk to Toshio about his work individually. So, over to you, Toshio Shiba. Hang on, I forgot something.
Just a second, would you like to ask the people in the back can
you hear properly at the back?
Yes. Yes.
You can? Okay. If you can't when these two start talking, then please shout. Right, Toshio, sorry.
Hello everyone, thank you for coming tonight. I'm Toshio Shiba. Well, first of all, I'd like to express my thanks to Daiwa Foundation for the opening tonight. And many thanks to the Ivashop Gallery, this show could never be possible without your effort. And my special thanks to Dr. Philip. Yeah, you've come here tonight. Busy time. We are acquaintances of 15 years now. And as he said, in 2013, he did a show at the Peabody Essex Museum about sale of the children. And we give a
Be a bit quiet.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
A bit quiet.
Can you
speak a bit louder?
Okay. Well, I would like to give a brief talk about my work. Well, actually, my way of photography is very simple. Just like I load up my photographic equipment in the car and go to find my photographic subject. In the winter, I go to south, and in autumn, humid summer, I go up to north. I've been doing this method for about 40 years now, since I started photography. Well, actually, I was a painter before, and in those days, I stayed inside a studio all day long and made many paintings with the idea that they're coming up from the inside. When I started photography, I found going outside and finding the unknown is such a wonderful thing, the openness and freedom I felt in photography in my starting point. I think the one of the important factors in photography is the light. Also, my mental condition is very crucial. Somehow, in a moment, these two are well unified. I think a good result is generated. Yeah, I'm wishing my each photograph can exist independently, like painting do. So, and when I look at the images as a whole, another world would appear, which is quite different from the reality. This is what I want to realize in my photography. Yeah, I hope you enjoy the show.
Okay, I'm going to show all these images.
So, yeah, I mean, it's up to you how you want to structure it.
Okay, PowerPoint. I should explain my work a bit.
Well,
this photograph, you know, in winter time around 3 o'clock. It's almost do you hear me? So I took this photo, you know, it's quite by accident, you know, when I, it's almost 3 o'clock in the time, so I just roll up my photographic session and going back to the hotel, but, you know, I just found this bridge. It's located in quite an isolated. When I found this, I just have a few minutes before the sun goes down behind the mountain. So I quickly set my camera and photograph, maybe in about 5 minutes or something. When I took this photograph, I didn't know that this photograph became so famous. Yeah, my way of work is something a little bit like that, you know. I just encounter with my subject all of a sudden.
So Toshio-san, this might be a good moment for me to jump in and ask you a couple of questions, because I think this picture is really inspiring.
Yeah.
I remember when I first saw this picture, I accused you of something that you didn't appreciate. I said that I thought you were becoming romantic. But, you know, there is something about a bridge, and the exhibition is called Bridge, and there is something symbolic and meaningful about the notion of a bridge, a connection between two points. Here we don't know where the bridge is actually leading. The picture's always meaningful, but they're not always symbolic.
Yeah.
Do you feel there is some symbolic content in this picture?
Well, it's about, if you find it so, it's a color. Green background and red color, it's kind of complementary color. So,
but what about red as the color of Tory Gates and all of this sort of thing?
Well, red color is kind of very remarkable, so most of the taboo is the red color.
The But you don't see any spiritual connection between the color red?
Yeah, at the moment when I photograph, usually I feel nothing. I try to feel nothing. I try to make myself empty. I just do photograph that very
As if I could intercede, the whole essence of the Japanese aesthetic is nothing, whereas the Western concept is things and association with things. But in the Japanese aesthetic, no association necessarily, no imposition.
Right, this is why I'm drawing Toshio out on this question, because I think it's really interesting.
Could I ask you to repeat what you said about the color red as part of or symbolic of Torii Gate? I didn't understand.
Well, I mean, is there an association with religious practice, with royal practice in Japan that you are thinking about? But I think you addressed that by saying that, no, actually you're open when you make the picture. But then there's a second part to that, Toshio-san, which is after you make the picture and then you're evaluating the picture, does that invite another level of thinking about what you've done?
Yeah, you're right. The moment I photograph, I try not to think anything. After I select my words, maybe I just not pick up. But I don't. But still, I really pick up my works out of something around the screen. Without consciousness. Many times the other people select for me, like Martin or some artist or my friend or Yoko. I'm really, it's kind of, how to say that, it's not something aware of what is good or what is bad.
So you said that you didn't realize when you made this that it would become so famous.
Yeah.
Are you surprised?
Well, in a way, yes.
As a photographer myself, I know exactly what he's saying. You take a picture that's a good picture at the time. Afterwards, you evaluate it with other things, like what's inside it.
So, well, the story is too much complicated. So I go to the next thing.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, this is taken in Nikko City. Nikko City is very famous for the Tokugawa Shogunate graveyard, but this is the outside of the Nikko City. And there was a copper mine, and because of that, there was no trees and grasses growing. And they tried to recover. But I didn't mean very political ideas when I took this picture. Well, this is a spillway of some downside in Shizen City, kind of prefecture. It's the west part of Japan. I take a lot of downside, because I'm very much interested in water. Well, we discuss about water. The subject later with Philipson.
But I think it's also interesting to ask at this point
about
some of your early influences when you began.
Yeah.
Initially in Japan as a painter, and then as you discovered photography more and more and worked in Belgium.
Yeah.
Who were some of the photographers that you were looking at?
Yeah, because, you know, as I said, I was a painter, and, well, actually, I major in oil painting in my university, but you know, it, I felt oil painting is too heavy for me. Try to look for a other medium, and I found Robert Rauschenberg's work. He used the photograph and from the six screen process on his work. So I started the screen process and tried to make it work with a drawing with my hand. So I'm just, bit by bit, I'm interested in photography. One-year work in a movie company, came to Belgium. But in Belgium, I wanted to do a lot more oil paintings and printmaking, you know, kind of stuff. Director told me to join to the photography department in the academy. Because photography department in the academy was newly built, needed some numbers of people. So I just followed the advice. And then I started photography. So, and I was, as I said, I was in the studio the whole time. I was struggling with my idea that comes out from the inside. And when I started, when I left photography, it's kind of feeling, you know, freedom, work outside. It's so nice. So I'll be happy. It's just, doing photography.
But you've already mentioned Robert Rauschenberg, and as a young Japanese artist at that time, were you looking mainly at Japanese examples or mainly at American and European examples?
Yeah, American and European.
Why? What did that offer you?
It's like with painting and drawing, it should be it's supposed to be very skillful. But I thought that is not art. It may be art, spiritual art is something else. So I just draw my drawing and using my hand. So.
But with these, I mean, this is not a particularly early photograph, but with the earlier photographs, there is something extremely precise and meticulous and technical about your photography at that time.
Yeah, because at that time, and in Japanese photography, it's more like a daido movie, or very wet rain and a very poetic. But I was interested in that kind of. I'm more interested in the, in an aesthetic way, something the forms and tones. Then I found.
So were you thinking about people like Edward Weston, Ansel Adams, that West Coast of America school?
Yeah, particularly Edward Weston's work.
Particularly Edward Weston.
Because when I saw his work of shells and pepper, he photographed paper, but to me, looks like something else. It has another dimension, different world.
It's funny you say that, because downstairs in your student work, there is a pot or a pan, and it's standing on its end, and it reminded me a bit of Weston's
pan.
But that's not a coincidence. That actually was an influence for you at that time.
So I ordered a book of zone system from New York, the Geographic Society, and I allowed myself.
And did you learn the zone system, Ansel?
Right.
And did you use it?
Yeah, I've been using it. Yeah, when I was taking black and white. I came to Bonn at that time in 1978 to buy my photographic equipment. That was the first time to be in London and the last time. Oh, <yeah. laughs> I come here. Thank you so much. This is the Yamagata Prefecture. The inside, vineyard, grape, they grow grapes inside.
So this is an invitation for another big question about your work, and that is Japan as a subject matter, because we see downstairs there's photographs of America, there's photographs of Belgium, but throughout your career you've gone back again and again to certain kinds of structures in Japan.
Yeah.
What is it about the Japanese landscape that attracts you so much?
Yeah, Japanese landscape. When I started photography in Belgium, I felt tried to find my everything, what I see is kind of very fresh, because I didn't know, but I realized that this is the kind of travel photograph. Maybe I should go back and try to cover what I know better than I belong. Japan is a very small country, but so many variety of land, and in the north, the whole country, it's very small and cold, like Alaska. And in the south, it's the Okinawa Island. It's a very tropical. Different things and strange things is that the people are living in very inconvenient mountains. I don't know why that is actually. But our land is about 75% is mountain. And we have so many rains, earthquake and typhoon, so many disasters. Land, actually, country.
So a lot of what you're photographing is almost a struggle against those things. It's an attempt to control nature, that you've got the erosion control and the barriers and the bridges and the structures that are holding back all of these natural forces. Is that right?
Yeah, right. So that I've been traveling through all of Japan so many times, but each time I go back to the same place, it changes. Well, this is a hip city, Kumamoto Prefecture. I visited there in 2015. Right after I visited there, there was a big earthquake. So many landslides and it's always changing, land is always changing by earthquake and typhoon. So it's like a seedless, when I go back to the same place, it's always changes, in a very short time. It's like, I became like a bit by the maniac,
But it seems to me this is a really beautiful thing because, I mean, in spite of the change and the damage and the struggle that's going on, this feels like one of the enduring themes of Japanese art, and that is the attempt to control and shape nature and human interface with nature.
Yeah.
I mean, would it be overstating it to say that in a way these kinds of erosion controls are almost like bonsai? That's an overstatement.
Sometimes I feel really, it's too much, because when I found some very small way, go up to the mountain. At the entrance, it's very small and rough and quite natural. Mm. But when you go up, it becomes like a highway, you know, all of a sudden. But no one using that road, something like that. There's many times like that, just spending their money.
So this is something we were talking about before the discussion, that is the politics of some of this. Why, I mean, obviously there is a need for a lot of these constructions, but who are the companies that are producing it? What is the political motivation of the local politician who is commissioning these things, and so on?
But when I look at the people working there, just, you know, like they're working on their road just in front of your house or something like that. The people are working on making your body something like that. But, you know, naturally, it is necessary things to have a dams and retaining walls and new roads because people are still living.
So how is photographing these kinds of things in, say, Belgium, different from photographing in Japan?
Actually, I have photographed in Belgium only the bridge, which is a commission work. So, you know, but the story is a bit different. But I've worked in the United States for several years as my personal. Well, like, this is a coolest dam from Arizona. This is also the commission work from MCA Chicago. They do this 3 years behind the U.S. And I traveled through all the United States. This is one of the I made over there. But this looks quite similar to Japanese way to construct banks. A very clean surface and well made. But well, compared to Japan, the way they make the infrastructure, it's a bit different. But, in the United States, they have enough land to make a very rough, just cut the mountains very roughly, and they can keep the space next to the road. And the land is very hard, it's very rocky, so they don't have to put the concrete on the wall to cover the weakened wall. But in Japan, as I said, the land is very soft. It's very muddy, so they always have to put concrete on to cover it.
But is there something about the approach to that kind of construction in Japan, an aesthetic of engineering works that's particular to Japan? The repetition of form, the patterns, there seems to be an attention to detail with this kind of construction that one doesn't see in other countries.
Yeah, I have, once I have heard from the constructor, like when they make a dam, they make a layer of concrete, and once they put concrete, they just wipe out before they put before the next concrete on, something like that. Also that
so something that no one will ever see, actually. That they want the surface to be perfect. Interesting.
So, this is another part of the
Can you tell us a little bit about your approach to time in your photographs?
Yeah. When I was making a bottom-up work, I didn't like very harsh light, you know, like when you see all these pictures. I prefer to photograph in a very crowded area or a very soft light. Maybe very early in the morning or after the dusk, something like that. But well, with my color work, actually, I like very. Like, I didn't care much about
But very often, what I was alluding to in that photograph is with water, very often you're allowing a little bit of blur. You've got a fairly long exposure time, so it gives it a kind of an evocative sense of time passing.
Oh, yeah, right. Actually, I'm using very large form of photograph. And negatives. So when I started photography, I just take a focus 45. So it's like an old custom.
In other words, it's so for those who are photographers, if you make the aperture really small, it makes the picture sharp. It gives you a lot of depth of field, but it makes the exposure time longer.
Because I think focus 45 is prior. And this time forward maybe 1 second. Well, I'm not intending to take a long exposure.
It was just a consequence of the technical challenge. So you wanted everything to be sharp.
Yeah, right.
And naturally the water had to flow. But it's such a beautiful effect. I mean, there must have come a moment when you said, actually, this is really working.
Well, actually, I'm not quite ready.
No.
Well, when I started, this is about old works of my color work, 2008. In these times, well, I'm very much aware of color, that I'm doing color work. Still containing the feeling of the black and white works. So I didn't care much about technical things.
So can I, sorry, I don't want to interrupt you, Toshio-san, but 2004, you made a momentous decision to stop making black and white photographs. So prior to that, you worked exclusively or almost exclusively in black and white. In 2004, you stopped and changed and now you're doing exclusively color. Can you explain your thinking about that and why that happened?
Yeah, because I've been doing my black and white work for about 25 years. I felt I didn't. I'm done. And actually, I fed up with my and when I think about my age, maybe I should start something new. That was the point. Right, so, but,
so it's only been 14 years of color.
Yeah.
10 years from now, you're going to have to change again. Maybe go back to black and white.
No, I don't think so.
Are you never tempted?
Yeah.
Do you ever see a photograph, you see a scene and think, actually.
I'm still making some prints. But no, I don't photograph prints. It's fun to photograph color. Now I know that they don't. Because with color, it's more free. I can feel free with color. Because with my black and white work, I use the 8x10 cameras.
Yeah.
That allows maybe 2-3 different lenses only. So that always have to work inside that limit, with the 3 lenses. But with color, I use 4x5 robust, but it gives more length. So,
but I'm interested in the absolutism there. For 25 years, I only do black and white, and now I only do color.
Yeah, because when I was doing black and white work, maybe I should do more. It's kind of obsession. Or I can make much better work with black and white, so that I continue. Of course, I've been doing some color work besides black and white. I couldn't stop. This is the work I made in Belgium when I was drawing photography.
So I asked you this 5 years ago when we did our exhibition together, and I'm going to ask you again today. Mm-hmm. When you look at your career and you reflect on your style of photographing, can you see differences? Can you see changes in approach that have happened over that 40-year period?
Well,
apart from the black and white and color.
Yeah, well, I mean, basically, I don't change the way I photograph. That said, with color, I can use more different lenses. That means I can get more different views.
So sometimes you're actually standing farther back, I've noticed, than earlier in your career. But that's just the lens.
Mm-hmm. Well, not only the lens, I think, but also the light. With black and white work, I needed soft light. I could work only under that light condition. With color, I can take almost any time. That makes a big difference. My approach to the subject is unchanged.
Well, I can already tell from the beginning of this dialogue that there were a lot of questions in the audience. So I'm going to throw it open to the audience in a minute, because I know we don't have a huge amount of time left. But I did just want to end with one last question based on the introduction that you made. And you said that the photographs depend in some way on your mental condition.
Yeah, right.
And I would love to, I think that's a good way to conclude our discussion and ask you, do you have happy photographs and melancholy photographs? And,
it's like, you know, working outside, especially suburbs of the city or in the countryside, it's very fun, to work, because no one can disturb me, you know, but when I work in the city, so many people around, it's kind of disturbing to me. But in the countryside, I'm very free, and then I'm very feel positive to create something, really want to photograph or something like that. But that means mental things. I think that mostly I'm happy.
That's a great place.